بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله تعالى نحمده ونستعين به ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله تبارك وتعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله تعالى فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى، وأحسن الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. نسأل الله العزيز الغفار أن يجيرنا وإياكم من عذاب النار. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He is worthy of being praised subhanahu wa ta'ala. We thank Him for His generosity and for the bounty of Islam, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase us in this bounty as far as our knowledge and our deen and our deeds, and to keep us steadfast on the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. We're still in the middle of our conversation about what to do after Ramadan, the necessity of staying strong and being steadfast on the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as each one of us did in the month of Ramadan. Since the month of Ramadan, as we will see in more detail inshallah throughout this mini series, is only the beginning. It's not the end. The end of Ramadan is the beginning, since Ramadan is a period of internship. It is a school that we enter every year. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees that we get rusty every year, and He brings Ramadan around so for us to enter this school to get trained again how to be righteous Muslims by coming to the masjid every day, by fasting every day, by all of these tremendous deeds that we are able to do, and the things that we're able to accomplish in the month of Ramadan, and we see ourselves too weak and too tired and too incapable of doing the same thing outside the month of Ramadan. It is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He makes it possible. He gives us the energy and the strength so that we will enter that school and excel in it, and then we come out successful, and we try to carry that success all throughout our year until another Ramadan comes to save us from ourselves, subhanAllah. So the month of Ramadan is a safety net. Imagine yourself as the life of this world, or the rest of the year, is like a big ocean. You're swimming, and right before Ramadan, you are tired and you start drowning, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saves you and pulls you back and says, okay, He puts you back on the straight path. And that is if you do what you are supposed to do in the month of Ramadan. That is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned this last week. That is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون. The fasting was prescribed, ordained upon you, as it was ordained upon the ones that came before you. Why? so that you might attain taqwa, piety. And subhanAllah, there were many pious individuals before the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And subhanAllah, top of that list is Anbiya wal Mursaleen, the prophets and the messengers, and they all used to fast, and so did their people, and so did their nations, they all fasted. SubhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it mandatory upon them as He made it mandatory upon us. And I mentioned a few the things that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said about the month of Ramadan and about the fasting in general. And we mentioned that word, Junnah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, As-sawmu Junnah. And I explained that word a little bit. Junnah is a protection. It is a buffer. It is something that keeps all the evil at bay. It all keeps the shayateen at bay. It keeps the things that will pollute your soul, will pollute your heart, will pollute your acts of worship. It keeps them away. And I gave an example, if you remember, either last week or the week before. SubhanAllah, when a person is fasting, he is more careful with what he does. All of us fall into these small things here and there, looking at something you're not supposed to look at, find yourself confronted in a situation you're not supposed to be in. But subhanAllah, when you are fasting, you are extra careful because you don't want your effort to go to waste. You don't want to be spending your day hungry and thirsty. And then what happens? SubhanAllah, what happens to you? You end up losing the reward for your fasting. And remember the hadith that I mentioned, the Prophet said that if a person does not leave off, قَوْلُ الزُّورِ مَنْ لَمْ يَدَعْ قَوْلَ الزُّورِ, the person that does not leave off قَوْلُ الزُّورِ, meaning any kind of falsehood, fall into any kind of falsehood, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not need. Allah is in no need for that person's hunger, and He's in no need for that person's thirst. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to see a taqwa from all of us. So we started mentioning some of the benefits of fasting, either in Ramadan or outside Ramadan. And I mentioned, subhanAllah, it develops in a person a ibadah called al-muraqabah. And subhanAllah, siyamu yunammi fil abdi ibadat al-muraqabah. وهذه سبحان الله عبادة يغفل عنها كثير من الناس. The fasting develops in a person this ibadah called al-muraqabah. What is al-muraqabah? Who can tell me? As I mentioned it last week. What is al-muraqabah? Muraqabah, if you translate this word from the Arabic language to English or any other language, it means that you are, it's vigilance. You're watching something. The muraqabah. They call muraqib someone who is like a supervisor, any kind of situation. Hal muraqib, someone who is vigilant. And, you know, subhanAllah, a person who is, for example, protecting a place, or he's always doing al muraqabah, watching for any kind of dangers. But this muraqabah here is of a different nature, and it's the best kind of muraqabah. Muraqabatullahi azza wa jalla. Muraqabatullahi azza wa jalla. And it reminds me of that tremendous hadith of Jibreel that is very well known to everyone. The hadith narrated by Umar radiallahu anhu. He said that we were sitting with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and there walks a man that has very nice white and clean clothes, and his hair is dark and his beard is dark, and he does not look like he was traveling, and nobody knows him from Al-Madinah. And subhanAllah, it is something strange, because Medina, everyone knows everyone. Then there comes a person that does not look like he's been traveling across the desert, but he is nice and clean and does not look disheveled or anything. It is suspicious, it is strange. He walked in and he said, Salaam alaikum, and he sat down so close to the Prophet ﷺ, knee to knee, his knees to the knees of the Prophet ﷺ, and he put his hands on his knees. Whose knees did he put his hands on? Who can tell me? Did he put his hands on his own knees or on the knees of the Prophet ﷺ? Because in the Arabic it says, وَضَعَ يَدَيْهِ على ركبتيه. It could be either way. It could be his knees or the knees of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. But which one is it? The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. That's what you think? You sure? Who can tell me something else? The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم? No, actually. Sitting in front of someone who you're going to learn from with your hands on your knees, your own hands on your knees, that's an adab. That's showing how to be mu'addab with someone who's going to teach you, subhanAllah. So he put his hand on his own knees. رُكْبَتَيْهِ هُوَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ جِمِعَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ SubhanAllah, and he proceeded to ask these questions. He said, Ya Muhammad, O Muhammad, tell me about Islam. And the Prophet told him that five pillars of Islam, that you to bear witness that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah, and that Muhammad is his messenger, and to establish the salah, and to give the zakah, and to fast the month of Ramadan, and to do the pilgrimage with the hajj for whoever is able and capable of doing so. فقال ماذا؟ قال صدقت. He said, you told the truth. فعجبنا. قال رضي الله عنه عمر رضي الله عنه فعجبنا منه يسأله ثم يصدقه. We were surprised, we were amazed by this. He's asking the question, he answers and he says, yeah, you told the truth. حدثني عن الإيمان. Tell me about إيمان. Then he proceeded to tell the six articles of faith. SubhanAllah, to believe in Allah and His messengers and His books and His messengers and SubhanAllah and His prophets and al-yawm al-akhir, the last day, and the divine decree, whether it's good or bad. The six articles of faith that everyone knows, SubhanAllah. Then, SubhanAllah, he asked him, tell me about Ihsan. So we're going up in degrees. First degree is Islam. He says, Shahadu an la ilaha illallah wa Muhammad Rasulullah. That's the first degree, the first category. But it's not really quite, it doesn't really get you there because you need Iman, which is a higher category, to have believe in those articles of faith. But SubhanAllah says, حدثني عن الإحسان. Tell me, what is Ihsan? What is Ihsan? Who can translate this word Ihsan correctly? When someone does something really good, what do you tell them? Ihsan. What do they say? Bravo, right? You did something good. Ihsan. Comes from Hasan. Anything that's good, you say it is Hasan. SubhanAllah, something good. Al Ihsan is, SubhanAllah, it is a mannerism. It is an adab. Yani it's something that a person, it comes within the core, becomes part of the person to do certain things. But the Prophet ﷺ explained it so eloquently. He said, أن تعبد الله كأنك تراه فإن لم تكن تراه فإنه يراك. Ya Allah. So the Ihsan is to worship Allah as if you were looking at Him. Imagine now. Imagine if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a manner that befits His majesty is right there in front of you. How would you be handling your daily affairs? How would you be worshiping? Because if you put it in perspective, very, very quickly, put it in perspective. You go to a place, and then you are living in a country, and you are summoned by the king of that country. You come into his court. You see things that amaze you. The entourage, the people that are protecting him. It gives you kind of a reverence. It puts fear in your heart. So you know that even if you want to scratch your ear, you got to think about it twice. You want to scratch your nose, you got to think about it twice. You got to say, no, I'll do it later. You can keep your chin. You know, I'll do it later. Because he's looking right at you. But this is something that we tend to forget when it comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is constantly looking at us, especially when you're in salah. And that's why sometimes I'm amazed with people that are doing all kind of gestures. If you see them, and then when you hear a noise, they turn and look, and their heart is not there. The question is, if you were able to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when you're making salah, would you be doing the same thing? And of course, the answer would be no, because nobody is crazy enough to do that. So this is what it's ibadah. It is so important. أن تعبد الله كأنك تراه فإن لم تكن تراه فإنه يراك. To worship Allah as if you are looking at Him, and if you are not looking at Him, then He is looking at you. It is called al-muraqabah. And if a person perfects this muraqabah, what happens to him? he reaches the category of what? Al-Ihsan. Because this is the key to Ihsan, it's right there in the hadith. You want to reach Ihsan? You want to reach Ihsan? Then have this mannerism and this act of worship that is called Al-Muratabah. And then Muratabah, incidentally, is something that has to be instilled in all of us at a very young age. Because wallahi, except for the ones that small exception that Allah bestowed His mercy upon, and then rahimahullah, the ones that were not trained to do al-muraqabah, it becomes very difficult for them when they're older. You see him doing things, and you ask him, subhanAllah, Allah is looking right at you. Oh, it's okay. Allah, before rahim, He's forgiving. You know, it doesn't even bother them. This muraqabah has to be part of us from the beginning, and we have to do so for all of us that have small children. We really have to strive very hard to teach our kids al-muraqabah. Make sure that when he gets in trouble or does something he's not supposed to do, give all the hawl and the quwwa, all the might to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not to you. Alhamdulillah, I hear it a lot of times. My own wife, she's doing that a lot. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward her. She tells him, you know, I'm nothing. What am I going to do? I'm nothing. I'm nobody. I'm just your mother. I'm a human being. What am I going to do? I'm going to punish you, and then what? Don't worry about me. Worry about Allah. He's looking at you. And His punishment is really severe. If His punishment comes down on you, you will not be able to handle it. And this is, subhanAllah, something that I advise myself and all of us that have small kids to always, always do that with the kids. Because with you repeating it on a daily basis, one day you will stick and you will have muraqabah, subhanAllah. And for us, the ones that, you know, fatah al-qitar, the train has left the station, but subhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings the month of Ramadan around and this ibadah of fasting for us, so that we learn and train ourselves again to do this ibadah of al-muraqabah. If it was not for the muraqabah, you're fasting, even in Ramadan, and you're by yourself in the house, the refrigerator is right there, water is right there, nice orange juice, apple juice, all that good stuff, and you're thirsty and hungry, all you have to do is open and start eating and drinking, right? Who's going to stop you? Who stops you? Al-muraqabah. The muraqabah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now subhanAllah, number two, and I mentioned this before, one of the benefits of fasting, تدريب العبد على التحكم في نفسه وشهواته. To train the believer to control himself and to control his desires and his wants. SubhanAllah, there's a big difference between wants and needs, and a lot of times we lost in wants and we, subhanAllah, we overlook the needs we take for granted because they're taken care of. We are worried about wants, and this is also something that we have to train our kids to be careful with. That's not about wants, it's about needs first. And those wants, subhanAllah, they are secondary. We can stay without them. Especially that these too many wants will spoil your deen. Too many wants, because you're following your shahawat, will spoil your deen. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us not to follow the shahawat. وَأَمَّا مَنِ اتَّقَى وَأَمَّا Surah Al-Nazi'at. Who can tell? وَأَمَّا مَنْ طَغَى وَآثَرَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا وَأَمَّا مَنْ طَغَى فَأَمَّا مَنْ طَغَى وَآثَرَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا فَإِنَّ الْجَاحِيمَ هِيَ الْمَهْوَى. Allah, whoever transgresses the limits and pushes the limits, وَآثَرَ الْإِثَارَ is to give some advantage to something over something else. وَآثَرَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا, give an advantage to الحيات, the life of this world. فإن الجحيم هي المأوى, then the abode, the dwelling place will be الجحيم, والعياذ بالله, the hellfire. وأما من خاف مقام ربه, as for the ones that fear to stand in front of their Lord, ونهى النفس عن الهوى, and they forbid themselves, their own nafs, from the lower desires, the vain desires, فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from the people of the Jannah. Then the Jannah will be their abode. Number three, subhanAllah, to be able to control yourself when you're angry. And I remember mentioned this last night. Anger, subhanAllah, gets the worst of a person. The Prophet said, verily the shaytan runs in the veins of the son of Adam like the blood. And the shaytan, the material that he's made out of, is what? A smokeless fire. So the shaytan becomes a fire in your veins when you're angry, and it pushes you to do things that you will regret. And the minute you do them, what happens? He runs away from you and says, I'm innocent of you. And he leaves you by yourself. SubhanAllah. The shaytan runs in the veins of the son of Adam like the blood. So beware of anger, subhanAllah. And the Ramadan fasting, the month of Ramadan, and fasting in general, helps you control your anger. And incidentally, the Prophet said, if you find yourself extremely angry, what do you do? When you're standing, what do you do? Sit down. And then if you're sitting down, then lie down, because subhanAllah, this will decrease your anger, and it will calm you down. Also, another way is to immediately go do wudu and to pray two rak'ahs. That will kick the shaitan away from you. The shaitan that is burning in your veins, he will get him away from you. And the fasting also helps you do that. SubhanAllah. A sign, the person that fasts, هو أجدر الناس بالإحسان. The person that fasts is the one that is most worthy and most prepared to be kind and to be merciful to others, subhanAllah. Because he tastes the hunger and he tastes the thirst, and he, subhanAllah, he feels for his brothers and sisters in Islam that are experiencing this all the time. SubhanAllah. But we just get a glimpse when we fast the month of Ramadan, we get a glimpse of some of the suffering that some of our brothers and sisters in Islam go through, especially in countries of calamity, countries where there's war. You find that there's food and water shortage. You find people that used to have, like, take for example Syria and Iraq and other places. You find people that had their home, they had their work, they had their businesses, everything is going. All of a sudden you'll find them, subhanAllah, trying to drink from any water stream that they find. You'll find them trying to fish food from the trash cans. This is a reality, subhanAllah. This, the fasting, the month of Ramadan, makes a person more generous and makes them feel for the brothers and sisters that are suffering. Fasting, also, subhanAllah, the fasting person is the one that is supposed, the one that is prepared to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more than anybody else. Al-shukr, shukr ni'mah, shukr ni'matillahi azza wa jal. Because the fasting person is grateful for the opportunity to fast, to do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're sacrificing something for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the first thing. The fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised that the reward for fasting is tremendous. Remember the hadith that I mentioned last week, إِلَّا الصَّوْمُ فَإِنَّهُ لِي وَأَنَا أَجْزِي بِهِ. Except for the fasting. All the deeds of the son of Adam are for him, except for the fasting, it is for me, and I am the one that rewards for it, subhanAllah. And I said, remember what I said about this? When the reward of a deed is unknown, it is unclear, it is concealed, what does that mean? It is huge. It is tremendous. And this is, subhanAllah, the reward of the fasting. It is absolutely tremendous, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed in that hadith Qudusi. So, thank you Allah for the opportunity of fasting. Thank you Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that reward that He promised the fasting person. Thank you Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when you break the fast. How sweet is that first sip of water? How sweet is that first date? SubhanAllah. I've experimented with some of my friends that were not Muslims, and they wanted to fast. So I encouraged them, they fasted, and we broke the fast together. As I gave them I said before on a date to this is subhanAllah. This is the tastiest thing I have ever had before, subhanAllah. Because fasting, you are longing and you're looking forward to that first sip of water and that first morsel of food. It tastes so good, and you are thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that, and you're thankful to Allah that He gave you water and gave you food after the hunger of a whole day or the hunger of many hours, as subhanAllah many were deprived of that. So subhanAllah, many things that we get from the ibadah of fasting. Number six, the fasting, al-siyam wa yurabbi al-abda ala tarki al-muharramat. It educates you. Al-tarbiyah, it is hard to find a really correct word to translate the word al-tarbiyah. Al-tarbiyah is what we all do with our kids for years, from the moment that he's born until he becomes an adult and he's on his own. All you're doing through that, bringing a person up, is a tarbiyah, subhanAllah. That's why one of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Rabb, لأنه يربي عباده بنعمه subhanahu wa ta'ala. He brings up, and subhanAllah, he allows his servants to grow up until, you know, from young age to adulthood with his na'am, with his bounties, because he feeds them and he clothes them and he gives them water, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he teaches them things. رَبُّنَا الَّذِي أَعْطَى كُلَّ شَيْءٍ خَلْقَهُ ثُمَّ هَدَى. When Fir'aun, عَلَيْهِ مِنَ اللَّهِ مَا يَسْتَحِقْ, when Fir'aun asked Musa and Harun, who is this Lord of yours? وَمَا رَبُّكُمَا يَا مُوسَى, who is this Lord that you're talking about? There are so many answers come to mind when someone asks you that. But subhanAllah, the Anbiya, the prophets and messengers, they're always so eloquent when they give their answers. They give you a very concise answer, but subhanAllah, to really dissect it, you need days and days of talking. They say, رَبُّنَا الَّذِي أَعْطَى كُلَّ شَيْءٍ خَلْقَهُ ثُمَّ هَدَى. Our Lord is the one that gave everything His creation. Then He did what? He guided. He guided. There's a story that was talking about this particular concept of hidayah, of guidance. They said that, subhanAllah, there was someone that did his specialty. He works with insects. He does research when it comes to insects. He is doing research on ants. And they noticed that when ants find any kind of grain, they cut it in half. For some reason, they cut it in half. And then they stash it in their food stash, you know, they eat it later. Of course, when they looked it up, of course, it made sense, it's obvious. The grain in the soil, if you leave it, you don't cut it in half, what happens to it? It will sprout, it will grow into something, subhanAllah. So these ants go into any kind of university to learn this stuff? No. رَبُّنَا الَّذِي أَعْطَى كُلَّ شَيْءٍ خَلْقَهُ ثُمَّ هَدَى. They brought, if I remember correctly, another grain. And this grain is, I think, parsley or cilantro, one of them. The grain of one of them. Knowing that even if you break it in half, it will still grow. They gave it to the ants and they watched. And to their shock and their surprise, the ants break it in three pieces. They break it in three pieces, subhanAllah. Who gave them this knowledge? رَبُّنَا الَّذِي أَعْطَى كُلَّ شَيْءٍ خَلْقَهُ ثُمَّ هَدَى. Our Lord is the one that gave everything His creation, and He gave guidance, subhanAllah. Even some scholars tell you that, if you ask them about evolution, they tell you, yeah, we have evolution in Islam. We do have evolution in Islam. This is it. The guidance of Allah. Allah brings forth, He creates His creation the way they are. Perfect. They don't change into something else. But their evolution, the way that the creation, they evolve, is in their knowledge. And the things that they have to do, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches them. He gives them al-hidayah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that guides his servants, he's the one that guides all of his creation, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And subhanallah, so many of these examples come that subhanallah person hears from the scholars talking, but it's really amazing the fact that even if you look at just the world of the animals, you will see amazing things, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the perfect creation to each animal, and he made that animal what is the word that I'm looking for? Specialized. He makes him specialized in that, in the things that they have to do, and they give him all the skills to help him with those things, subhanAllah. Similarly with the son of Adam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided the son of Adam and gave him the brain that he did not give the other animals, and he helped, of course, that brain with what the most important thing that the sons of Adam received from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all throughout history is what? Yeah, it is al-wahy. It is the wahy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because if it was not for the revelation, this will be worth nothing. It will only cause destruction. It is the revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that guides the sons of Adam. So the fasting, it keeps a person away from the haram. It trains a person to keep himself away from the haram. And it trains you to look for all the permissible things and all the things that please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you do them because you want Allah ta'ala to be pleased with you on the day of reckoning. Number 7 of the Siyam, it develops something very, very important. That thing is called al-yaqeen. Al-yaqeen. Now if I told you to translate wa'bud rabbaka hatta ya'tiyaka al-yaqeen, how would you translate it? And worship your Lord until what? Ya'tiyaka al-maut. Jazakallah khair. The translation of yaqeen is certainty. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this particular ayah, wa'bud rabbaka hatta ya'tiyaka al-yaqeen, it means until death comes to you. That means hold on to your Islam until death comes to you. But the yaqeen here that I'm referring to is the certainty that fasting in general, it develops that yaqeen, that certainty that you have in Allah, that belief without any doubt that you have in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you did not have yaqeen in the existence of Allah, did not have yaqeen that there will be a day of judgment, if they didn't have yaqeen that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will hold people accountable and he will reward others, would you be fasting a whole day? Would you be keeping yourself hungry and thirsty? Absolutely not. So subhanAllah, fasting develops your yaqeen and your belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of course, at the end of the day, with fasting comes that most important reward that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the ayah in Surah Al-Baqarah, the ayah that talks about the fasting, and that is at-taqwa. At-taqwa. If all of that, the subhanAllah, the natija, the end result of all these things that we talked about is called at-taqwa, piety. And if a person reaches piety, if he's given piety, he is given a tremendous gift. Because it is the muntaqoon, the people of piety, that will have the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Only them. Allah ta'ala mentioned it many times, the Prophet mentioned it many times. The muntaqoon, the people of taqwa, are the ones that will have the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reach them. And no one enters the Jannah with his deeds. Anyone that will enter a Jannah, it will only be with the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he is the best of all men, the best of all the sons of Adam. He said it himself, subhanAllah, he said to the Sahaba, he said that you will not enter the Jannah, you will not enter the Jannah except with the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, wala anta ya Rasulullah? Qala wala ana. You're not even me. إِلَّا يَتَغَبَّضَنِ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ بِرَحْمَتِهِ, except that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows His mercy upon him. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bestow his mercy upon us. We ask him subhanahu wa ta'ala to be merciful with us and to look on our very, very small needs and to accept them, and for him subhanahu wa ta'ala to overlook our transgressions and our trespasses, and for him subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from the ones that when they hear the speech, they follow the best of it. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم وسبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك والحمد لله رب العالمين وجزاكم الله خيرا. Because I think it was either partially or cilantro. I think it's maybe partially lower. But it seems like the seed, the partially seed, if it is partially, if you break it in half, it will still grow. Break it into two pieces, it will still grow. So the ants broke it into three pieces. Exactly. Break it's common. They break all the other seeds into two pieces and they broke this one into three pieces. SubhanAllah, SubhanAllah, Rabbil Arshil Azim. All praises to Allah.
My question is,
Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu
alaikum. You mean slaughtering in the Eid for, no, actually it is in the Sunnah. And inshallah I will do a series about the adab of Eid. It is in the Sunnah to slaughter for someone, a beloved one that passed away. You can do that, this one. You cannot do salah for them, but you can do sadaqa for them. You can slaughter in their name. Actually I did so for my father, rahimahullah, may Allah, you know, have mercy on his soul. Just last year, I slaughtered two, one for myself and one for my father. You can do Hajj and Umrah for a person, as long as your Hajj was done first. If you do your own Hajj, then you can do it for somebody else. And this, actually, Qurbani or slaughtering, the sacrifice of Eid, you can do it in the name of somebody else and you will receive the reward, inshallah ta'ala. And inshallah, when the time comes, I will do a whole series about it. I don't know in what context Shifrad said so. Alhamdulillah, he has good knowledge, mashallah. If you want, I'll ask him just to see what context. Might have been something that was out of context, you know. Maybe, yeah. But it's, I mean, I know for a fact that it is part of the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that you can actually slaughter for someone and get the reward for it, inshallah ta'ala. They have to be believers. Absolutely, good point. They have to be believers, because otherwise, I mean, nothing will reach them, because the unbeliever, the person that doesn't believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam died upon that, they have no needs. They have no needs. Even if they need some good things in their life, they come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they find zero. So they have absolutely, a person has to be a believer before that would do anything. So subhanAllah, I encourage everyone, if you're able to, and you have a loved one that passed away, you can do sadaqah for them, you can do a lot of dua. If you're able to, you can do a hajj for them, you can do a umrah, and you can do a qurbani or sacrifice for aid for them, inshallah.
To me, it sounds like
it's a
waste of life.
Yeah.
Is there any threshold for that?
But there's no threshold. The time of the Prophet, all the Sahaba, they all slaughtered their own sheep. The Prophet used to slaughter too, usually. And the Prophet made sure that he ate from all of them. They took parts of each animal and they made a soup out of it, so that the Prophet would eat from all of them. So if someone is able to, of course without being wasteful in the Mubadirin and Ikhwan al-Shayateen, the wasteful ones are the brothers of Shayateen. So it is a fine line. A person is not going to be wasteful, and he's doing it for the sake of Allah, and there is need for it, and there's enough people that to be fed, then why not? Allah Ta'ala, Allah Ta'ala knows best. One. Yeah, one. It is one, one per family, and bigger animals, there's seven families can each family can do one. Yeah, one. Or they can do one, the tour. You can do more than one. But one is the minimum, of course. Inshallah, I will do, being in that, I will do a series about the... I'll do so before that, inshallah, so we all have an idea. All of us will be reminded of what we have to do, inshallah, and we know we have to stay away from. So this is a lot of information that has to do with fiqh of Eid al-Adha, inshallah. Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum.